Macmillan Audio presents LA Weather by María Amparo Escandón. Read for you by Frankie Corzo. I believe Icarus was not failing as he fell, but just coming to the end of his triumph. Failing and Flying, from Refusing Heaven by Jack Gilbert. 2016. January. Sunday, January 10th. The twins were here 1 minute, gone the next. Conceived in vitro, Diana and Andrea had enjoyed the care, nurturing, and love that their parents selflessly offered in abundance after having birthed them under such despair, artificial, anti-natural, miraculous, controversial, and diabolic, as Aunt Belinda had pointed out in a hush-hush tone outside the delivery room to her friend Bertha, who heard nothing since she'd forgotten her hearing aid at home, circumstances. And so, over their 3-year lifespan, the girls had accumulated a wide array of colorful beach balls and inflatable cartoon characters that were kept in their grandparents, Kayla and Oscar Alvarado's oversized kidney-shaped pool. This kind of swimming pool was a near-mandatory feature in almost every West Los Angeles backyard. But, regrettably, due to a state of neglect that had lasted well over 10 months, it was filled with greenish standing water up to 4 feet deep, in which colonies of mosquitoes and other winged and long-legged insects thrived, with no reason to envy life in the humid thickness of the Amazon rainforest. Permanently suspended on a blanket of rotting leaves from the sweet gum trees that lined the yard, the half-deflated toys had developed layers of slimy mold. But still, the girls loved their toys and knew where they were, even in the after-dusk darkness. And so Diana tried to reach a mermaid and Andrea a hippo, and both girls fell in, one right after the other, while Grandma Kayla opened the door for the pizza man. It was 6:48 p.m. Holding the large deep-dish pepperoni and anchovy pizza warm in its box, Kayla called her granddaughters for dinner, searching for them in their secret hideouts around the house. Not quite 60, she moved about the rooms with the agility she had perfected over years of yoga practice. Her complexion showed barely a wrinkle, mostly ironed out with a little Botox here and a little filler there. A meticulously selected strand of gray hair fell on one side of her forehead. The rest of her soft curl bob she colored dark brown. She first went out the back door to the end of the yard and checked in the detached garage, home to everything but cars. Oscar had used the right side of the space as a gym before he acquired the habit of watching the Weather Channel for 8 hours at a time. Now, the dumbbells, the Nautilus, the treadmill, and the Soloflex were under a tarp, waiting for the next guilt-driven exercise outburst, which would not come. Oscar's lack of interest in things, especially his inattention to the backyard and the swimming pool, had been gradual but complete. Her husband of 39 years, a passionate, entrepreneurial, honest, faithful, charming thinker and achiever, was no longer himself, and so her vagina became off-limits to him at the same time the backyard went feral. Next to the exercise equipment were 3 bikes last ridden 12 years ago. The blue one belonged to Claudia, Kayla's firstborn. The pink one was Olivia's, her second daughter and mother of the twins. And the red one with the basket was Patricia's, the youngest of the three. To one side of the bikes, a file cabinet, which Oscar kept under lock and key, acted as a partition wall. Its top drawer contained folders and more folders filled with love letters, postmarked in the 70s by the Mexican and the U.S. Postal Services, organized chronologically. The second and third drawers stored tax returns going 10 years back, just in case. the birth and marriage certificates of Oscar, Kayla, and their three daughters, school diplomas and special papers and projects, old insurance policies, and anything else from the past that might be needed in the future. Kept in an acid-free envelope was Kayla's U.S. certificate of naturalization, along with an American flag no longer than a handkerchief, and a welcome letter signed in facsimile by President Reagan. In the bottom drawer, the original grant deed of the family home in Rancho Verde, owned free and clear since day one, had developed a slight, musty smell caused by the humidity that seeped from a slowly leaking pipe below. Next to the cabinet, an artificial Christmas tree, divided into four sections carefully wrapped in heavy-duty trash bags for protection from dust and vermin, was leaning against three large suitcases from the pre-wheels era. Two of them were packed with ornaments and lights and fireplace stockings and a nativity complete with the Holy Family, shepherds, sheep, an angel, and the three wise men mounted on their elephant, camel, and horse, respectively. The third suitcase contained a menorah, a box of candles, honey jars, Seder plates, and other celebratory Judaica. To the side of the door, in the most accessible area, were the earthquake survival kit with enough emergency supplies for the entire family, and the fire evacuation suitcases ready to go at a moment's notice.
"Be prepared, always prepared," Oscar would often tell his wife and children.
Kayla, now a bit annoyed, called out to her granddaughters again. They were elsewhere, definitely. It was 6:53 p.m. Her next stop was her art studio, adjacent to the detached garage. The door, featuring a colorful mezuzah attached to its frame, was ajar, so the girls could well have wandered in, even though they'd been instructed not to. The place wasn't large. A turntable, a stool, a work table, a toolbox, a gas kiln, and various buckets of different sizes and colors with dry and hardened glazes, slips, and clay were spread around haphazardly, making the room seem even smaller. At the far end was a shelf with several boxes marked with art piece titles and dates, but the absence of new work was evident, and more so to Kayla, who ran her hands over the smooth surface of the empty table and sighed. She had stopped creating her coveted stoneware sculptures of nude couples for the Brick and Spiegel Gallery in Mexico City as part of her crossed legs strike, a protest against Oscar's apathy. She missed the feeling of her fingers squeezing the malleable clay into bodies that burned with desire. Her last series conveyed the opposite, lack of interest. The girls were obviously not in the studio, so she continued her search in the house. After making a stop in the kitchen to leave the pizza on the counter, Kayla went upstairs to the bedroom that had once been Olivia's, the twins' mom. Two pink blankies were tossed on the unmade bed where the girls had taken a nap that afternoon. The winter sun had set a while ago, but the moon was bright among gray clouds and offered Kayla enough light for a quick search behind the couch, in the closet, under the bed. She wondered why she had agreed to babysit the twins again, after the last scare, when Andrea had put a pinto bean up her nostril and she'd had to pull it out with a pair of tweezers, the toddler kicking and squirming in her arms. She looked in the other bedrooms and went downstairs. Maybe the girls were exploring the Forbidden Forest, the once dazzling backyard's landscaping now in full deterioration. It was now 6:59 p.m. 2 minutes later, Kayla heard Olivia calling her. She and her husband, Felix Almeida, were back from their lunch at the marina, a six-hour affair at Vittorio's involving altogether too many hugs and kisses and promises to schedule future get-togethers with friends they hardly ever saw, following the baptism of Donoso's 47-foot-long Hans Christian offshore explorer sailboat, the Ugly Duckling. Kayla came out of the shrubs, annoyance gone, frustration vanished, and now, quite a bit worried.
"I can't find the girls."
Olivia dropped the doggy bag with quail egg ravioli and saffron cream sauce and shaved Parmesan cheese leftovers and yelled to Felix, "Look in the pool." It was 7:03 p.m. Olivia jumped in and sloshed in waist-deep murky water looking for her girls among plastic hippos and mermaids and rotting vegetation. Kayla and Felix waded in behind her. The moon was no longer sharing its light with the early evening, so they had to rely on what their feet could sense, a frenzied search for bulk, a body. Olivia bumped into something, a bucket. Kayla's leg got tangled in kelp-like weeds. A timid drizzle announced an overnight downpour, a cause for celebration given the drought. But no one was celebrating, not in that pool. Before he knew for sure his twins had drowned, Felix dialed 911 on his cell phone and yelled incoherent sentences like, "They must be in the water," and "Get here now," until the operator managed to obtain enough information to dispatch an ambulance. Dragging their feet, the three combed the bottom of the shallow side to the deep end. In the same high-heeled shoes in which she'd accidentally put a tiny scratch, unnoticeable, really, on the ugly duckling's polished deck that afternoon, Olivia was now frantically kicking decomposing debris around the pool where she'd learned to swim, barely a toddler 33 years ago. Until she found Andrea, then Felix found Diana a few feet away. They pulled their daughters out onto a lounge chair and began mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Kayla ran to open the front door for the paramedics, two young men loaded with rescue equipment who ran straight to where the girls were. No need for directions, as if they'd performed previous drills in that particular house. The twins were hastily resuscitated. Both coughed up water and began to cry almost simultaneously.
"A miracle," cried Kayla.
It was 7:12 p.m. Olivia rode in the ambulance and Felix and Kayla trailed behind in her Jaguar. While the paramedics worked on stabilizing the girls, who were now wrapped in thermal transport cocoons, Olivia compressed herself into a corner so as not to get in the way, nauseated and half listening to the EMS responders talk about a certain condition, the diving reflex, some medical explanation of the girl's impossible survival. Was she making this up, or did she really hear it? She blamed her mother for her unfit, careless babysitting. Blamed the Donososes for buying a new sailboat. Blamed Felix for having talked her into going to the marina. And most of all, blamed herself for insisting on having babies when not just nature, but the entire cosmos had been against the idea. She wished she could blame God. But all of a sudden, she doubted he existed. Once the girls were rushed to the ER, Olivia, Felix, and Kayla were guided to the waiting room, where what seemed to them hundreds of hours went by. Olivia's wool dress, Felix's slacks, and Kayla's sweatpants dried while they paced around. Felix held Olivia's hand tight and looked out the window, as if he were about to jump off a cliff and drag her with him into the void. A janitor came by to mop the little puddles of muddy water that had been dripping off their clothes. That's when Olivia noticed that she'd torn a strap on one of her fuck-me-now shoes, as Felix called them. She never wore high heels to work. She spent most of her days walking around dusty construction sites full of obstacles in houses and small apartment buildings she bought to flip and sell. High heels were for weekends, not scaffolds.
"How did you know to look in the pool?"
asked Kayla, breaking the hour-long silence. Olivia could not answer Kayla's question. Her jaw had become locked, and her teeth ground against each other as if trying to block her rage from escaping in the form of words. But her attempt at keeping the situation civil failed as she let out a loud, injured animal-like squeal.
"I'm never, ever letting you watch the girls again. Never. And Dad, where was he?"
Monday, January 11th. Oscar's chair had developed a concave shape over the years, like a hammock, punished by his persistent weight. He had logged several hours in front of the TV in the sitting area outside his bedroom, without minding the fact that it was turned off. He'd do that sometimes, more so lately. He'd spend the entire night staring at the dark monitor before making a decision. Eventually, he'd point the remote control and hit the power button. The skies had no intention of clearing up. The Weather Channel said so, though the much-announced thunderstorm had become a broken promise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.